Now, I'm like the warm-up band at a rock concert. I'm not the person you're here to listen to, and I make sure that I keep my set short. Now I want to introduce Rodney Glasgow. He has devoted his life to social justice. He hails from Baltimore, where he attended Gilman School, which he agreed could be characterized as the Belmont Hill of Baltimore. And those of you who remember Mr. Whelan, an English teacher, that's where he went as well. Mr. Glasgow graduated from Harvard University with a joint degree in Afro-American Studies and Psychology, and he earned a master's in organization and leadership from Columbia University. He is one of the founding members and now chair of the National Association of Independent Schools annual Student Diversity Leadership Conference, a 20-year-old training ground that draws over 1,500 high school students every year from around the country. He is a member of the advisory board and vice president of equity and justice for the National Association of Independent Schools. He was on the board of directors for the Friendly House, a Worcester-based community empowerment organization, and a community solutions council specialist for supporting positive youth development with the United Way of Central Massachusetts. He used to live in Worcester. In 2009, he was given the People of Courage Award by the City of Worcester for his work with the Greater Worcester Community Foundation's LGBT initiative. Mr. Glasgow has been the diversity coordinator at Grayland Country Day School, assistant head of the upper school and director of diversity for Worcester Academy, and currently is the head of the middle school and chief diversity officer at St. Andrew's Episcopal School of Maryland. Every one of our students and teachers who have heard Rodney speak have come away moved and deeply inspired. So we are honored and delighted to welcome him here today. Rodney, welcome to Commonwealth.
Good morning. It's hard for me to think about where to start. Because when Monica asked me to come and do this, I was a different person. And we were a different country. And what I imagined I'd be up here saying is completely different than what I'm going to have to say. So I'm going to have to get comfortable and let the universe take over. So when I get comfortable, I start with taking my shoes off, and then we're going to do that. These are, because I know you can't see them, and you should, these are my Rockports. I do have a pair of Kenneth Cole Unlimited Editions that I wear that are like my favorite pair of black pumps. But I didn't bring those because those are like the mega shoes. And I thought today I wanted to put off an image of humility as much as one can. And I'm going to take my socks off. My socks are just plain old socks. It's a shame that I put them together with those beautiful shoes. But I want you to know, if I was as ambidextrous as I wanted to be, I would have lift my foot up so you could see that I do have pedicured toes, which allows me to take my socks off. I wouldn't do that to you. And people ask me why. I start most speeches with taking my shoes off. And I do that because that's what I do when I come home, naturally, every day, the same ritual. Kick off my shoes, and if I'm wearing socks, I take off my socks, and I leave them right there. So I want you to know that I'm at home with you this morning. And you're going to see me in my most authentic self this morning. And that because of most recent events, I don't even know who that person is. But I'm going to share him with you this morning. The other thing I think about when I take my shoes off is I go back to a foundation for me, which is Christianity and the Bible. And I'm not one who sat and read the Bible every day. We didn't go to church every week. We were not that family. But we were prayerful, we were spiritual, and we were definitely Christian. And there's a part in the Bible early on, in terms of Bible sense early on, it's such a big book, and Moses is walking up. And he sees this incredible image of a bush that is on fire, that is burning, but not burning away. And his natural curiosity leads him towards the bush. And a voice speaks to him. Presumably the voice of God. The first words that God said to Moses were, "Remove your shoes because you're standing on holy ground." So every time I take my shoes off, it puts my feet firmly on the ground. It grounds me literally. But it's an invitation to come into holy space with me. It's a reminder that my feet actually can make holy ground because I'm standing on it, because I'm a piece of the divine, because God is moving through me. And so by element of putting my feet on the ground, I've made the space a little more holy than it was. Praise be to God. If we ever needed holy ground, we need it this morning. I don't know, dear friends, I thought about yesterday was a tough day. And it's kind of like when someone passes away, right? My grandmother passed away recently. And the day you have the funeral, everybody is in the emotion of it. And everybody is taking care of you. And everybody is crying with you. And everybody is sharing your grief. And then they go to the repast and they eat up all your food. Right, at least that's what we do in Black culture. And then they go home. And because it wasn't their grandmother who passed away, they go to work the next day. They go grocery shopping. They tuck their kids in at night. They have their coffee in the morning. And you're still sitting there that day and the day after that and the day after that thinking, I want to do those things, but how do I do them without my grandmother? Today is that day where there were some people for whom yesterday was an awful day, but they just attended the funeral. Somebody didn't pass away for them. So they grieved with us yesterday. But today, they went to Starbucks. They drove their cars to work. They watched Good Morning America. And it was the same America for them. But for me, the day was different. Because a piece of me died yesterday. And so I don't know who I am right now as I try to resurrect some piece of myself that doesn't even fit here in the country anymore. So if you're going to know me, you got to know that I was born in Baltimore to a single mother. And we were poor. And she was a teenage mother. And at the time in which I was born, 1979, by the time I reached a teenager, by the time I was your age, the news was projecting that black men who were born in Baltimore, in the space I was born in, who lived below the poverty line like I lived, would not live to see their 21st birthday. I watched family members die. I watched the news of black people killing black people and white people killing black people. I was a statistic. I was not supposed to make it. So for Bill to get up and read my bio and say I went to Harvard and then Columbia, or that I even got through Gilman, those are incredible things. But the most incredible part about it is that I lived to stand here and tell you about it. Because I was not supposed to be here. If you're going to know me, you have to know that I was not supposed to be standing here, because from day one, I was counted out. That teenage mother gave birth to a 3-month premature black child in the ghettos of Baltimore. You could hold me in the palm of your hand when I was born. I was black and fragile, just like I am today. And the doctor took my little self and put me in an incubator. And for the remaining 3 months, every now and then someone could hold me, but not long and not much. I was born closed off from the world. It's no wonder now that I've been given the blessing of life, that I'm embracing the world the way that I am, because I didn't get to do it from day one. And that doctor, tall and white and handsome, my mother would talk about him, looked at her and said, I don't know if he's going to make it. And she said, he will. And grace of God, he did. Right? And then she took me home. And 2 years later, that little asthmatic little baby who made it out of that incubator caught pneumonia. No, I don't remember that. But I know enough about pneumonia to know that it could kill a grown person. So a little baby who almost didn't make it. And the doctor looked at my mother and said, I'm going to tell you right now, Miss Little, your child is not going to make it. And my mother, young, black, poor, some might call her uneducated because she did not make it to college. It took everything she had to graduate high school. And the reason she didn't go was because she had a baby. And everything that she wanted to do, because she was fiercely intelligent. She is fiercely intelligent. My mother talked about on a snow day from school, she would still walk to the school. And I said, Mom, why on earth would you do that? And she said, because just in case the news got it wrong, I didn't want to miss a day of learning. That's my mother. So that she put her college dreams on hold and said to this child, you're going to do those things I couldn't do. And then that doctor told her, but he's not going to make it. She said, what can I do for the baby? Notice she didn't say, oh my goodness, what can I do for myself? How can I prepare myself for the grieving? She said, no, what can I do about this? And he said, all you can do is take him home and make him comfortable. He will die most likely in his sleep. He will suffocate to death. The mucus will settle around his lungs. You can help him out. He'll feel better if you just massage his back. It'll break the mucus up and let him breathe a little longer. But that's just about making him comfortable. He's not going to live. You need to prepare yourself. My mother looked, short black woman, at that tall black man who had all the degrees she didn't, had all the book knowledge she didn't. And she said to him, you're a smart man, but I'm a faithful woman. I didn't do all this work for this child not to make it. I'm taking my baby home and I'll massage his back. But I'm going to tell you right now, he's going to live. It's not an option. I don't know how. You can't tell me how. But I'm going to live with my child. And she would say that every time she massaged my back, it was a prayer that I would live, that I would have voice, that I would be somebody, that I would go the places she couldn't. And grace of God, I did. I was not supposed to be standing here. I was a weak child. Flintstone vitamins made me strong. They were too delicious. I ate them up. And now, here I am. But I tell you that story because it's everybody's story. And yesterday, and the day before, I looked at those election results, and it pained me, because what I didn't see was Hillary versus Trump. I didn't see that. I felt like I was on the ballot. I felt like the country was voting for or against me, whether or not I could be an American, whether or not I could sleep at night peacefully, whether or not I had the right to be black, to be gay, to be gender fluid. This is what 50 million people voted against. And I watched it happen. I watched my country that I love, that I fought for, vote against me. It was deeply personal. And I couldn't sleep. And I had to get up and try to put my shoes on and go to work. And all I could think about were a few moments in my life where I felt that same way. I'm going to take you back to Gilman School. on a diversity day like we're having right now. In the 90s. Headmaster opened it up the way Bill did. And we went about some workshops the way you're going to do. And the Gilman School was a progressive school for an all-boys school that was 100 years old when I graduated, right? It was built for white men, and there I was. And I was myself at the Gilman School. But they didn't know what to do with me. And there were some students who didn't understand it. And there was one student, and he knew how to get me. He knew how to find me. And whenever I would walk the halls, this student, and he was tall, and he was big, and he was white, he was muscular. He looked almost like the statue of David. I'm sure he was on some kind of steroids. And he was a wrestler. And I had this weird thing going on, because when you were gay in the 90s, you didn't talk about it. When you were gay at Gilman School in the 90s, you didn't talk about it. We had one student who was older than me, and he wanted to take his boyfriend to the prom. We had never heard of such a thing, and the headmaster said, we can't allow him to do it, but we have to respect him. He can't bring his boyfriend, but we will help him understand this character flaw. And for him, that was being progressive. So little Rodney Glasgow couldn't even process these feelings I had when I looked at this white boy and with this strange attraction and repulsion. And he would walk up to me and get really close to me. And when he would walk up to me, the first time he did it, I didn't know what to do. I mean, here he was, everything that we crave for, right? He was white, he was handsome, he was smart, he was buff, he was athletic, he came from money, and here he is walking towards me. And my little self, I'm like, well, let me get it together because he's coming. He's coming towards me. This is like the day. And I see him getting close, and I'm like, okay, I got to stay in here. Don't let my hands sweat. And I'm thinking, is he really coming towards me? Because it looks like he's looking at me, but we're in this crowded hallway. And then I'm like, oh, he's looking at me. Oh, yeah, he's looking at me. And I'm like, oh, he's coming towards me. Oh, he's coming towards me. And he's still coming towards me. Now I'm standing stock still, right? Because when you have that joy and fear together, you don't know what to do. So I stood still, and I'm like, okay, he's coming. Oh, he's coming really close. He's coming really close to me. And I'm thinking, he's coming up to my face. He came close enough that he could have kissed me. And he leaned in, and I'm like, I'm just going to stand here. Lord knows I don't know what's about to go down. I'm going to stand here. And in my mind, I thought he was going to kiss me right there. And he leaned into my ear, and he said, you're nothing but a faggot. And we talk about words. But it wasn't a word that he said. He punched me in my stomach that day. Because not only did I not even think about being gay, even though I wanted that boy to walk up to me and kiss me, I couldn't even have words in the 90s to talk about being gay. But the way he said it, if you've ever had somebody make you feel like you were nothing but something that they picked up on the street on the bottom of their shoe, if you ever had that happen, you know how I felt that day. But Gilman men, we'd learned to stand there. So I stood there and I took that from him. And as much as I wanted to cry, as much as I wanted to wilt away, I had to stand there and be firm and look like I was not being degraded. And then he just walked away. And he did that to me once a week for several years. And I sometimes saw it coming and sometimes didn't. And nobody ever questioned, what is that boy doing so close to that boy? They don't talk to each other. This boy, his mind was aggressive. We at the Gilman School had a tradition. Our school was on a big hill, like a big hill that went down into the football field. And when it snowed, because in all-boys school, we had some crazy traditions. When it snowed, the tradition was the seniors would go into the freshman locker room and grab a freshman and get a running start with the freshman, throw the freshman down on the base of the hill, jump on top of the freshman, and sled the freshman down the hill. That was our tradition. And what was interesting about it was that freshmen, like, they hated it and they loved it at the same time. Right, if you were a freshman and the senior picked you up, it was like a senior saw you and thought you were cool enough to sled down the hill, right? That's like some internalized depression mess, right? But they loved it. I was never one who had that happen to me. I think it's because the boys didn't want to get on top. To get on top of me would have been something different. So I never experienced that. But I remember the day a young man who did experience it in one of the worst snowstorms ever, and underneath all that snow was ice. And so when the senior took that freshman and threw him down at the base of the hill and jumped on top of him and sledded him down, his face got piled up with the ice, and it broke his nose. You saw blood all down the hill. And the boy's mother, like private school mothers would do, but any mother would do it, right, called the school and raised holy hell. I can't believe what is going on. So the headmaster had to stand up and say, and this is like crazy stuff that people have to say, right? You actually can't take another student and jump on top of them and ride them down the hill. I'm just going to make that policy today. Right? And then he said, and we had this tradition, he said, and I know this is a big deal. I know this is a big deal, so I'm going to ask that all the faculty leave. I'm going to step out. Your student government will help you to process this. And I'm sitting in like the twilight zone, like, who needs to process that? You just said we can't actually grab another individual and ride on top of him down the hill. I think it actually makes sense. But that was me. It actually didn't make sense to a lot of people. And that same person who terrorized me every day, for some reason, the universe is so crazy. For some reason, he sat really close to me in the auditorium, close enough that I could feel his heat rising as the president of the school tried to debrief and get us on the same page as to why, because the police were called and all these other things happened, this is why we can't do this. Not because it makes no damn sense, right? That's really why you can't do it. And then my bully got up. And when he got up, I shut down. But I couldn't slink down because Gilman boys don't slink down. And I just prepared myself. And he was angry and he started with the fist. And he said, you know what? This fucking sucks. We sled freshmen down the hill. This is Gilman. I'm like, this is what Gilman does? Okay. We sled freshmen down the hill. You know what? My grandfather went to this school and he sled freshmen down the hill. My father went to the school and he sled freshmen down the hill. You're turning us into a bunch of pussies. And I'm like, I don't know where we are right now. But for him, it was real. I tell you that's the kind of person that he was. And on this diversity day like we're having today, at the end of it, I was sitting in the hallway doing my homework. And I was by myself. And I heard the door open. And it was that creak, like the horror movie creak. Right? And I looked up. Because when you hear that, it's like, okay, this is either the part of the movie where the killer runs at you really fast and you didn't see it, or where the white girl tries to run away from the killer and she falls down and starts backpedaling, but she's not fast enough. Right? Right? And I'm like, you know, I'm a little bit more like a white girl than anything else, so I don't want to be the one backpedaling. Let me try to figure out what I'm going to do. And here he comes through the door with another friend equally big. But I couldn't even be a white woman, because at least in the horror movies, white women had the luxury of running, whether they fell down or not, whether they got caught ultimately or not. Because a Gilman boy does not back down. So it was not an option for me to move out of that hallway, even though I knew danger was coming. I could feel it in my gut. I knew it was about to happen. And I thought, if I just stand still, they will not notice that I'm here. They knew I was there. They sat right across from me on the opposite wall. And I thought, if I just don't look at them, they will ignore me. And they started talking. And he turned to his friend and he said, you know, I'm so glad we have Diversity Day. I'm thinking, what? And he said, you know, because I like all kinds of people. I get along with all kinds of people. And it was so shocking to me that I actually broke my protocol and I lifted my head up in shock. When I lifted my head up, he was standing right across from me and he was staring me down. And it was like an episode of Animal Planet where the male lion sees the other male lion and it's like, okay, who's going to break the gaze, right? Which one is going to kill this one and take over all the females? Like, that's the moment we were in. And because I was trained, having gone to that school since sixth grade and now in high school, I couldn't be the lion that looked away and got eaten up by the other lion. I couldn't do it. And neither could he. So he's looking at me and he says to me with a look like he could spit on me if he was just that close or that good. If his aim was just that good, I do believe he would have spit on me. And he said, there's only one kind of person that I just can't stand. He didn't beat my ass in that hallway. I didn't come out bruised or broken bones. But I came out brokenhearted because that was the day. That was the day that I realized for who I was, for the simple act of being who I was. And I was born sassy. I was born gay. I was born black. I was born flamboyant. I was born a diva. My milk had to be a certain temperature. I raised holy hell if it wasn't. That was me all day long. I couldn't turn it off, but it turned him off. And when he looked at me as if I was a piece of shit on the bottom of his shoe, that was the day I realized that I could go through life being hated for something I didn't understand and couldn't control. They got up and left. And a couple minutes later, when the coast was clear, I got up and left. But I stayed in that hallway. My spirit stayed in that hallway. I didn't speak about this incident until I was 30 years old. For 15 years, I sat in that hallway. It's the reason I couldn't come out to my parents. It's the reason I couldn't let another boy get physically close to me. It's the reason that I tried to deny I was gay. Because gay is something that people hated. And when you put it with black, it's something that people felt like they could violate at any moment. I've been blessed not to have been beaten up in hallways like some children have been, but I have been battered and bruised. And so when I tell you, when I watched those election results and I was on the ballot, that's what I mean. To know my reaction, you had to know my story. You had to see me then go into my first independent school in Denver, Colorado. Anybody ever been to Colorado? You know, Colorado is a mile high. This was before marijuana was legal there. So it was the altitude that was messing with their minds. Now it was a different vibe. The people were crazy. And I went there because I wanted to be an independent school diversity director. And this was where I got my shot. I was 22 years old. And I went to that school with my manicured nails and my diva clothes. And the kids loved it, because what I love about children is they just love authenticity. As long as you are yourself and I can tell whether you are safe or unsafe, I can be cool with you. But the parents hated it. And all my family was struggling back in Baltimore. And here I am out by myself pioneering, hitting west like black folks did, right? Me, by myself, in my 20s. And I remember a month into that school year, the school that told me we are diverse, the school that said we need you, the school when I said, are you ready for me? Because I can't be in the closet anymore, you know? And they said, yes, you can be gay here. We don't have any other gay people, but you could be. I didn't even think it then, right? And I remember the day I walked to my mailbox. This was still in the times where you got physical mail. You didn't have it anymore. And I picked up mail, and I sorted some through, and I was walking with my friend Wine, cute little Asian woman, and she loves to talk. So Wine just talked to me from the building all the way to the mailbox. I picked up the mail, I'm sorting it, Wine is still talking. Wine is the kind of friend that could talk to you, and you don't ever have to say anything, because she actually doesn't want to hear anything you have to say. She just wants to be able to talk and feel as if you're listening. And if you get the timing right, you can say, mm-hmm. Oh, I can't believe that, Wine. Really, he did that? Oh, my goodness. You have no idea what she's talking about, but she thinks you're with her. And so Wine is doing her thing, and I opened up one piece of mail, and I noticed it didn't have a return address. It looked a little funky, but it was mail. I just opened it thinking it was junk mail. Wine is still talking, and we're walking on the path between the buildings, and I stopped stark cold. Wine, bless her heart, is still walking and talking because she has not realized that I'm not with her because it was not the mm-hmm moment yet. So she's a little bit ahead of me, and I'm standing there holding this. And Wine would tell me that I turned stark white. That is my superhero power. As a black person, my skin actually can change color along with my emotion. And so I turn red when I'm embarrassed or angry, and I turn white when I'm frightened. And so I turned stark white. And I just held it up to her when she finally came back for me. And on this piece of paper was this old, you know, anybody seen the Jim Crow caricatures of the really dark faces and the bulging eyes and the bulging lips? So someone had gone to the internet and cut out a picture of that. And then there was a noose around it. And then, because we were in the technological era, instead of writing on it, they had typed up, "We thought this would make you feel at home, faggot." That was the heading. And then the closure was "nigger." And there I was, back to sitting in that hallway with that individual who taught me that faggot is the same as punching me in my face. And when you say "nigger," that's like violence to me. And when you add that to "we," but you don't sign your names to it, that's like KKK level to me. That means there's a group of organized people who are out to do me harm at any cost to themselves, and that there likely won't be a cost to them. And I was a Gilman man. So just like I did in that hallway, I took it that day. Wine was in crisis. She cried, "Oh my God, let's..." And I rode my bike to school because I was trying to live like a white Denver person, and they ride the bikes and hike and all that mess. So I'm on this bike. And I said, "Wine, I'm going to be fine. I'm going to get on my bike. I'm going to go home. If I need you, I will call you later." I said it just like that. But I got on my bicycle, and I rode down that same intersection I came up and down every day. But it was different that day. It was different that day because that day the cars didn't look like traffic. That day the cars looked like weapons of mass destruction that could aim at me at any moment. And in the middle of the busiest intersection where I realized I'm in the same neighborhood that we live in. One of these we's in their Lexus could divert and hit me on this bicycle. I had a full-on panic attack in the middle of the street. Alone and young and scared. And I got myself home and I called people. And all the people of color from the school, there were like five of us. Right? Said, we all got together in somebody's living room. And somebody said, "Rodney, I know this is upsetting for you, and I got to tell you what. They sent this to you, but it was addressed to all of us. Because when you use that word, it's all of us. Nobody is safe. We got to call the head of school." We called the head of school. The head of school is a Jewish man. And he came and met us at the apartment. And again, he doesn't know us because it's only October of our first year. What they did in that school was they brought in five new people of color at once. And people thought, "Oh my God, they're taking over the school. This should be familiar to you." Because when we voted Obama in 8 years ago, it was like all at once, they're taking over. And this is how we got to this election and these results. And the head of school looked at me and I said, "You know what, I'm the diversity director." I said, "We can't go to work tomorrow. Clearly, Rob, it's like we're raw. And if somebody could say something and we could go off, it's not safe for us." And he said something that changed my life. He looked at me, the youngest person in the room. And he said, "Everybody else here, if y'all want to take the day, I understand you're hurting, take the day off. But you, Rodney, you will be at work tomorrow. As your boss, I am telling you. And I looked and I said, why me? Just like that. You know, it's like that moment in the Bible. Why me, Lord? Hush, somebody's calling my name. And he said, well, because this is a diversity crisis. And so this happened to you, but you're also the person I pay to handle diversity crises. So you need to come to work tomorrow and do your job. And in that moment, if I could have grabbed that man by his neck and shook him, I would have. Because I thought, you don't understand. And then he said, no, I get it. I'm a Jewish man. I've been through the Holocaust. I said, not that he didn't, but his family had. And I said, then you get why we can't go. And he said, no, your power isn't coming into the building tomorrow. The community has to see your grief. The community has to see that you are still coming to work tomorrow. So I walked into that school. And by the time I got there that morning, he said, I called a community meeting and I showed every adult and every kid in this building what was sent to you. From the kindergartners on up. And I walked into a campus of crying children. Children who were afraid, children who didn't understand, children who, how could somebody do this to a man that we love, that we trust? And I had to lead them through it. But that morning before I got there, I had to think about, is this worth my life? Is this school in Denver, Colorado worth my life? Is going there tomorrow worth my life? Because I lived in the neighborhood where the Wees lived. So they had police detail outside of my apartment. I couldn't ride my bike to school the next day. They had to send someone to come pick me up and drive me to school. And when I got there, the police walked me to my office. If you've seen that picture of the Little Rock Nine from Arkansas, where they were coming in there with guns, anybody seen that one? They're trying to go to school and they got the federal troops behind them so they can get to math class. That was me. In 2002. But when I put those shoes on that morning, I said, I will die for this. I will die for my right to be here. I will die for my right to decide when and where I enter and exit. I will die for this. Independent schools love glass offices, so my office was all glass. You could see me from all angles. And I thought, somebody could shoot me today. But they're going to shoot me in this office. You're not going to keep me out of here. I will decide when I leave. Every day I went to that school was history, was integrating. And I stayed for 3 years and then I left on my terms. I had that same feeling when I got up after the election results. And I couldn't get out of the bed because I was terrified and afraid that someone had now permission to do me harm. I had lived that before. I lived my neighbor, whose son-in-law is a police officer, sending her son-in-law to my front door with his gun and his hand on his gun because I refused to move my car out of her parking spot. I lived the possibility of a police officer and a wife beater t-shirt and some gym shorts on a Sunday afternoon willing to shoot me in my home because I refused to move my car. I lived that. But in the time that I lived that, he was doing wrong. And after these election results, it's possible that if he did it to me today, he'd be doing right. To know me, you have to understand how I felt walking from the Newberry Guest House just to here. And I had to look at people in their faces because 50 million people voted against me. And I feel like if I can see your eyes, I can tell if it was you. And every time a white person wouldn't look at me or wouldn't smile, I couldn't tell if it was because they were introverted, because they were tired, or because they were racist, sexist, classist, and homophobic, and I was a piece of shit to them, and now they don't have to look at me and acknowledge that I'm standing here. And every person I passed, I had to put that test to. When 9/11 hit, I was living in Boston. And I remember the feeling when I left my office to go home, because terror had happened. And I walked out, and everybody looked different. Everybody looked like it didn't happen to me, but it happened to me. And I'm frightened. That was 9/11. I remember the nation's fear and the nation's being a victim of sanctioned terror. And on 11/9, it felt the same way. People had the same looks on their faces. People were terrorized and terrified. I had to be the middle school principal who pulled kids together at 8 o'clock that morning. And I said, just tell me how you're feeling. And it was a little wealthy white girl, one of the safest groups in America. She looked at me with tears in her eyes and she said, Mr. Glasgow, I'm afraid. We're living an era where children are scared of the president. I was sitting in my office and a little black girl came in and she said, can I just sit down? And I let her sit. And I said, do you want to talk about anything? What are we doing? I can be quiet. I can talk. She said, no, I'm just going to be quiet. And then she started talking in immediate tears. And I said, well, what's going on? And she said, the president is going to take my family from me. Some people in my family are not citizens. And they're not wanted in the country. They're going to take them. And I had to say, baby girl, he's not the president right now. So this is not going to happen today. And this is not going to happen at all. We are not that country where the president is going to come to your house and take your family. But this is what the children are feeling. I had a high schooler stop by my office that day in tears. I said, what's going on? And she said, after today, if somebody rapes me, I have to have that child whether I want to or not. And after today, I'm not safe. Somebody could rape me and it would be okay. And I said, baby girl, that's not happening today. That's not happening today. Another person came and said, we are Somali. And my mother looked at me during those elections. This is a tall, big football playing boy, a senior. And she looked at me and said, this country just voted that we do not belong here. They don't want us here. And he cried, why don't they want me here? So we will talk about 9/11, and we will talk about 11/9 as the day the country got terrorized. And this wasn't about Democrat or Republican. It was about Hillary or Trump. For people like me, for my own kids, my family, for kids in my school, it was life or death that was on the ballot. And yet, a people strong, renewed, every person of color I knew did not sleep that night. Every white person I knew did not sleep that night. Every wealthy person, every poor person I knew did not sleep that night. We were on the phone at 2:30. Somebody called me at 2:45 a.m. I need you to pray with me because I keep throwing up. And I got to go lead a school of children in a couple of hours. And we all got up and did it. You know, when they talk about Make America Great Again, when I first heard it, because my mind's a little silly, I thought, this is wonderful. We can make America great again. Maybe I need to vote Republican. I want to make America great again. This is awesome. So, okay, and I'm waiting for the platform because in my mind I'm thinking, we're going to make America great again. We're going to give the land back to the Native Americans. This is awesome. I'm ready. I will give them my land if it was perfect. I don't have to have it. They can have it. I said, okay, so we're going to get reparations for the slaves, and maybe those who want to go back can go back. I don't want to go back, but I will be glad for those who can, or write me a little check for all the hard work that my family did, and we'll be good. right? I'm thinking, okay, we're going to go back and turn back time, and women will be able to vote before 1920, and this will be awesome because we're making America great again. This is beautiful. I said, we're going to go back, and we're going to not intern the Japanese after Pearl Harbor because that was wrong, and that is why America was not great, and we're going to make America great again. We're going to start doing the right thing. And then I'm like, well, shit, that's not what they're talking about. And it's because I missed it. And what I missed, words are so important. It was the again that should have clued me in. Because I was talking about making America great. That again let me know there was a time when you thought we were great. And I don't know when that time was. But I can't go back there to that. Because it was great for you, but it wasn't great for me. There's not a time in this country that was great for me. So we can make America great now, or make America great finally, right? But we can't make it great again. So I finally said, can we maybe just make America good? Maybe that's the platform to run on. Can we make America good? Could we make it where I can do what I did last night? And I sat with Monica and Bob, a Peruvian woman and a 60s, maybe 70s, I don't know. You old white man. And a black man sitting at a table having wine and having community and talking like we had known each other our whole lives. If people looked at us, Monica, they wouldn't have known that was the first time I'd seen you. The way Monica embraced me when I checked into the hotel, it was like an old friend. Bob, a 70-year-old white man, I could have been skeptical of him. I could have been like, "You, who did you vote for?" Right? I don't know you, white man. But I embraced him, in part because he was with Monica. But I'm so glad I did. And as I sat there with them, I'm like, this is the healing process. This is what people all around the world need to be doing, not just in this country, but around the world. Let's sit and learn about each other. And we talked about what we didn't know. And I had a revelation that as long as I've done this work, there's 50 million people in this country that I don't know how they think. I don't know their story. I don't know why this resonated with them. And I need to understand it. I need to sit with a black person who voted for Trump. And first I need to say, what the hell were you thinking? And then I need to say, but do tell me, because I want to understand it. I need to sit with a woman who voted for Trump and say, did you see the video where he said he would grab you by your stuff? How could you vote for that? And then I need to erase the judgment and just say, really explain to me, how did you vote for that? Because I want to know your story. Let's take what has happened to us, whether you're a Democrat or Republican, whether you voted Trump or Clinton or a third party candidate or didn't vote at all. Let's take the reaction of this country and make it our tour de force, because right now we don't know each other. There was a whole section of America that we silenced. And just like black folks did in the civil rights movement where they said silence no more, this was just a group of people saying silence no more. I told you I wasn't comfortable with what we were doing and you forced me to do it. And now I'm taking it back. You could have sat with me. You could have talked with me. You could have helped me understand all this diversity stuff. You could have helped me understand why people who were born male want to be in the women's bathroom. I don't understand that mess. So I got to vote against it. And you're not listening to me. I don't get it. I'm not with this. And we were really good at squashing that voice and making it look like we were progressive. And the voice came back and said, wait a minute. Wait a minute. And we celebrate it when minority voices do it. And we mourn it when the voices of the majority do it. But it's the same principle. So you all sitting in this room, y'all are going to have to make America good again. It's going to have to start with today. It's going to have to start with closing the textbooks and opening the hearts and the ears and the mouths. And listen, don't be like wine. Don't just talk. Actually listen. And understand how we got here and how we move forward. And understand how even if you don't feel that way, There were also 50 million people who feel like the country just declared open season on them. I promise you it feels that way, because I've never felt more unsafe in my life than that 5-minute walk from the hotel to this school. And I forced myself to do it, because I'll be damned if I'm a target in my own country that then makes me a prisoner in my own home. That's my charge to you. I'm a different person today because I hesitate a little more to engage today, because I don't know who voted against me. And I'm going to get to the other side and decide that it doesn't matter, because I'm voting for everybody. Because even if you voted against me, I'm going to love you through that. And I'm going to be okay. Because my mother didn't give birth to that 3-month premature asthmatic pneumonic little baby who made it here for me to back down now. Praise be to God. Have a great day.